Good evening. My name is John Hallway. I'm the Executive Director of the Quattrone Center for the Fair Administration of Justice here at the University of Pennsylvania Carey School of Law. It's my great pleasure to welcome all of you to Seeing Us and Hearing Our Voices, a criminal justice conversation with Yusef Salaam and John Legend. We're very excited about this, and it's my pleasure to turn it over first to the Dean of the Law School, Ted Ruger.
Thank you, John, and thank you, Dr. Salaam and John Legend, for joining us and bringing your wisdom and thoughts with us. This is a moment in our country when the rule of law is under attack from multiple dimensions. We have seen in the past week, the past months, the past year, visible evidence of the work we have to do as lawyers and people committed to greater fairness. We've seen the inequities that stretch back decades and centuries of racial injustice and disparate treatment in our criminal and civil justice systems and in other aspects of our society that are manifest in the treatment of Black people and other minorities by police that manifest in differential sentences and really throughout our society. So this is both a moment where it is so heartening to see so many people from different parts of the country and different professions kind of in greater numbers coming together to discuss criminal justice reform. But you know, it's also a moment to be mindful of the fact that this is the inequities that will be that John Legend and Dr. Salaam will be discussing tonight have a very long history. And so I would urge us all to use this moment and not waste it and work. You know, today we will enjoy a wonderful discussion. But as we start tomorrow and through our careers as lawyers and educators and in whatever walk of life you're joining us from, you know, we want to turn from education and motivation tonight to implementation tomorrow and really make real world changes in the criminal justice system. I thank the Quattrone Center for bringing this together. And really this is in the theme of the Quattrone Center of implementing real world reform. I thank Frank and Denise Quattrone for their leadership and support and John Hallway and Paul Heaton and other faculty and fellows for leading this so well. So, and again, I thank our guests, Dr. Salaam and John Legend, to more properly introduce our speakers. And I'll turn it back to John Hallway with appreciation. The floor is yours. And I look forward, like the rest of us, to listening to this great discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean Ruger. And thanks for your constant support of the Quattrone Center and all the things that we try to do. Our two guests really need no introduction. I hope they can turn their screens on shortly, as both of them are world-recognized figures in their fields. Dr. Yusef Salaam is a member of the Exonerated Five, five teenagers who in 1989 were wrongfully convicted for the rape of a female jogger in Central Park. The case drew national attention at the time and has since become a case study really in how not to conduct a subject interview or prosecute a criminal case. It had elements of false confession, false testimony, bad forensics, police and prosecutorial misconduct, all combining to lead to their convictions for crimes they didn't commit. DNA evidence ultimately exonerated all five men, but not before Dr. Salaam spent 5.5 years in prison for a crime he didn't commit. You can hear more about the case in two fantastic movies, the celebrated documentary, The Central Park Five from Ken Burns, and more recently, the Emmy Award-winning Netflix limited series, When They See Us, written and directed by Ava DuVernay. Since his release, Dr. Salaam has used his platform to share his story with others and educate the public about the impact of mass incarceration and police brutality that are rooted in our justice system. He regularly advocates for criminal justice reform. We'll talk about a number of those today. And specifically restoring the humanity of those who were incarcerated and trodden down by the spike wheels of justice. Dr. Salaam has received a Lifetime Achievement Award from President Barack Obama, and he recently published the book, and I'm looking forward to hearing about this, the book Punching the Air with National Book Award finalist Ibi Zoboi. So thank you so much, Dr. Salaam, for being here.
My pleasure.
In addition to Dr. Salaam, it's obviously a pleasure to welcome back to Penn one of our most famous and celebrated alumni, John Legend. Many of you probably know John better from being one of only 13 people to win the EGOT, the Emmy, Grammy, Tony, and Oscar, because we're going to exclude the daytime Emmys from that, John. But it's also quite well known that you're a vocal and thoughtful supporter of criminal justice reform and a tireless advocate to reduce mass incarceration and to improve and reform the role of prosecutors in our communities, among other reforms. Mr. Legend is the creator of Free America, the co-creator, and I look forward to talking more about this, of the Unlocked Futures Accelerator to help returning citizens. And he routinely supports progressive prosecutors who are looking to change their jurisdictions with thoughtful reforms to reduce incarceration and wrongful convictions. Also, we're, of course, obviously thrilled to have you on our advisory board. So just so that we all know the ground rules, I think you all know this, but for the audience, we are being recorded. We are broadcasting this both on Zoom and on YouTube Live. We'll be here until 7 o'clock. Anybody who's on the Zoom channel can send in questions. We'll do our best to answer those questions in the time that we have. And I want to get right into it, but last but certainly not least, I do want to thank our founders, Denise Fodoraro and Frank Quattrone, whose forward-looking vision created the Quattrone Center and whose generosity has allowed us to do this meaningful work. So this is supposed to be a conversation. You guys should feel free to just talk amongst yourselves, but let me throw something out there to maybe start things rolling. It feels kind of, as Dean Ruger alluded, that as we enter 2021, that criminal justice reform is almost a completely different conversation than it was in January 2020. Since the unspeakable tragedy of the killing of George Floyd in May of 2020 and so many other additional tragedies that have followed since then, it feels like social justice issues and criminal justice reform issues have really come to the forefront for so many people. And I guess maybe I'll start, you know, the federal government's response has not been terribly reform-based under a president who actually once took out a full-page ad, Dr. Salaam, to advocate for your execution prior to your exoneration. We're changing administrations now, but the need for reform hasn't changed. And I guess I would ask both of you, but let's start maybe with you, Dr. Salaam, with the change of administrations, with the work that you're doing with the New York legislature, what are the areas that you see that are really ripe for criminal justice reform? And where are you really focusing your energies as we go into 2021? And then John, maybe you can follow up with a similar answer.
You know, I think about where we are in the country, and I can't help but also transport myself back into time. And in transport myself back into time, I'm thinking about what the founding fathers said. And, you know, the statement with which they began was, "We the people." We weren't considered people. We weren't considered full human beings. And so the same system that was put in place is the same system that is in place right now. It is the most unfortunate reality when you see that the people who have their knee on your neck as you cry out, saying, "I can't breathe," saying, "Help," calling for your mother in the case of that young man, are the same people that are there to enact the law, to uphold the law. You know, in New York, on the side of cop cars, it says to serve and protect. And throughout the country, as I've been traveling, we see those same words in some variation. And in New York in particular, they go one step further and say courtesy, professionalism, and respect. And I think that those are great ideals. It is a great statement to make. A young lady, when I was in California, 13 years old at the time, she said, "You know, I got a question. I want to become a cop. I'm a cadet right now. What advice can you give me?" And I swear, the first thing that came to my mind was run. Do not go into law enforcement. And then I realized something really important. I was talking to the future. I was looking at a future person that was wanting, that found their purpose, right? Dr. King said, when you find your purpose in life, do it as if God himself called you to do it at this very moment. And I'm listening and looking and seeing and saying to myself, oh, wow. And so I began to talk to her and I said, you know, when you look at the side of cop cars, it says to serve and protect. That's one of the most profoundly important things to do, to give over your life, your time, your energy to protect others. And on the side of cop cars in New York, courtesy, professionalism, and respect are the words. And I said, my advice to you is that you do your job. And so as I look at where we are, I'm thinking that the most important thing is that we need to have some very, very important, very powerful wins that don't speak to other folks who don't look like us being arrested and shot and so forth and so on, but for the playing field of what the criminal justice system is supposed to be about. That has to become true. We need to be able to live in a society where we are not afraid to be walking while Black, to be driving while Black, to just being Black, where we can't be unarmed because of the color of our skin. And I think those most important things are really being boiled to the top in this divided America, right? This divided states of America, as opposed to the United States of America, that we are in this election season, we're doing something very important. And I think we're finding that we have great power. And more importantly, it is not just about the next 4 years, but it is about the lifetimes to come. It is about us making sure that we live in, as they, you know, the term that they coined that I thought was so brilliant was Afrofuturism, that we live in this idea where we can imagine a world that is better because we are better, because we are the lights in the darkness, because we are fighting spiritual wickedness in high and low places.
Thank you. John, your thoughts?
I think, first of all, I'm so happy to be here with Dr. Salaam. We've not met prior to us joining this Zoom together, and I'm honored to be on this virtual stage with you, and I'm happy that we are able to have this conversation together. Thank you, John, for convening us and all the work that the Quattrone Center is doing to make the practice of law and the practice of criminal justice more just. I want to think holistically about what we expect our public servants and what we expect our government to do for us. And I think Dr. Salaam was pointing in that direction when he talked about protect and serve. But even more broadly, what we expect is that we're able, as a society, as a community, as a city, as a town, as a state, as a nation, to be safe, to feel safe, to live in healthy communities, communities where we help each other out, where if we see someone in need, we try to reach out to them and give them what they need, where we have schools that are well-funded and preparing our young people for the future, where we have systems in place that make it so that people can build a happy, prosperous, healthy, safe life. That's what we all want. And part of how we do that is through all kinds of individual actions and ingenuity and capitalism and all the other ways that we interact with each other. But part of what we all need is a government that helps that along. For a long time, so much of what we've asked the government to do is related to policing, jailing, imprisoning people to help keep us safe. And I think that emphasis, that focus on keeping us safe by causing harm, keeping us safe by causing harm, particularly to Black and Brown communities, has been so detrimental to actual public safety in our communities. And for too long, the government has seen its role as keeping everyone else safe from people who look like us, and not keeping us safe, not protecting and serving us, not providing public safety to us, but providing public safety to everyone else from us.
Yeah.
And my belief is that true reform, it means that we're building healthy communities where all of us, no matter what we look like, feel safe, where all of us have access to proper food and housing and shelter and healthcare and education, and are set on a good path so that we can build good lives, and so that we eliminate a lot of the conditions that lead to crime in the first place, so that we're all safer, we're all healthier, and we all live in loving, healthy, safe communities. I want our national leadership to have that in mind when they're making policy. I want our state and local leadership to have that in mind when they're making policy. And we'll get into the weeds of, you know, what prosecutors do and what police do and our incarceration problem. But I think holistically, we'll be better off if we spend way more of our energy and way more of our money focused on how we build safer, healthier communities, rather than using policing, jailing, imprisoning people to clean up all the mess that we've created by bad policies and bad outcomes that don't have the right priorities.
So thank you to both of you for those thoughtful remarks. And I know, John, the last time we had you on a Quattrone Center stage, you've always thought very holistically about these challenges. And you were talking about enterprise and opportunity zones at the time and investing in communities so that to help lift them up. And that itself is a criminal justice reform, initiative, right? Because all these things that we can do to address the income inequalities and the economic disparities will themselves work together to lift families up and drive positive change. And I've always admired the fact that you're willing to look at it at that high-end level. One of the kind of interesting evolutions that we've seen over the course of the past year has been the Minneapolis City Council, which in the wake of George Floyd, said, we're going to abolish the police, we're going to try something different. And then as many different parts of the community came forward and said, we actually do need a role for public safety, has gone back to revisit that. And one of the questions that we've gotten from the audience are sort of two questions that I might combine. One is sort of each of your thoughts about sort of radical reform versus incremental reform to reach these objectives that we all hold. The other one, though, is from a professor at Golden Gate Law School. And as a former San Francisco resident, I want to shout out to Golden Gate Law School, that has a number of students who are coming from both privileged and heavily surveilled communities. And they're curious about any words you might have for them going into the profession, how they should be using their legal skills and how they should be thinking about being the police officers, prosecutors, defense attorneys of the future. So why don't we flip the order, John? I'll go back to you and then we can turn to Dr. Salaam.
Well, I feel like you're asking me about defund the police and some of the conversations that have been either more radical, like abolish the police, or more conservative, like reform the police. I think there's been a range of slogans. There's been a range of actual policy ideas, but the bottom line for me is that budgets are statements of priority, and they're also moral documents. So when I say we should consider defunding the police, I'm not saying we get rid of the police, though some people are arguing that. I'm not saying we are, but I'm not saying we should. I'm saying we should look at our funding priorities and deprioritize the funding of police as they're currently constituted. And as I was speaking before, think about how we could invest that money in other things that would actually make us safer and prevent crime from happening in the first place, prevent despair, prevent homelessness, prevent all these other conditions in our communities that lead to crime, so that we would reduce the need for police. That's my basic prescription for how we think about public safety in our communities. And these are community decisions, because most of these decisions aren't made by President-elect Biden or Vice President-elect Kamala Harris. They're made by city councils, like you said, in Minneapolis, or by Cleveland, or by New York, or by Los Angeles. And so there are going to be groups of people that get together. They're chosen by the people, and their job is to represent the interests of the people in those meetings. So when they're thinking about what their budget priorities are, they have to decide, how much are we going to spend locking people up in our local jail? How much are we going to spend making sure we have an arts program in our schools? How much are we going to spend on fighting homelessness in ways that actually don't punish people for being poor, but actually give them housing options or mental health options that will help them not be homeless anymore and put them in a more stable situation. So all of these choices are being made, and they're being made with our tax dollars, and they're being made on our behalf. And so I think all of us have an interest in making sure that the right decisions are made and that we do things that are edifying for our communities. And my opinion is that it's more edifying for us to invest more money in quality of life, in health, in education, in improving the culture of our communities, in doing all the things that will make our communities happier, healthier, and safer, and reducing the need for us to spend it on as much policing and jailing and imprisoning of people. So I don't know the details of where Minneapolis is going to land, but I do believe that every community needs to sit together and say, here's what our tax base is. Here's the money we have to work with. How do we allot this in a way that reflects our belief of what morally is the right thing to do in our community? And I believe the answer will lie somewhere where we significantly reduce what we spend on punitive measures and measures of force, and significant increases in the way we spend money to promote health and education and safety and culture in our communities. It'll make us safer, it'll put fewer people in jail and prison, and it will save lives.
Well, I love the statement, budgets are moral documents. And yeah. I'm paraphrasing actually our president-elect, who at some point said, you know, don't tell me your values, show me your budget and I'll see your values.
Yeah.
And along that line, you know, one of my colleagues at Penn in the criminology department, a woman named Arlie Oos, published a paper that I think we gave you an early draft of a couple of years ago at a Quattrone Center advisory board meeting. What she's shown is that district attorneys do the majority of sentencing. You know, 90% of all crime in the country is local, not federal, local and state. So local district attorneys are handling these cases. And therefore, the sentencing policy rests mostly with local DAs. But when people get incarcerated for felonies, they then go to a state prison. And so the state bears the costs of the locality's sentencing policies. And what Dr. Oos's paper shows is that when you actually change that budget responsibility and have the costs run with the jurisdiction that's imposing the sentences, that sentences drop by about 2/3. Mm. And so it's a really surprising thing to think about how the mechanics of budgets really can control the philosophies of incarceration, of punishment, of criminal justice. So I think that's a terrific point.
This is why I love the Quattrone Center, because, you know, we could talk about all of these things in a moral sense, but there's also analysis and data and experimentation that goes with this. And for us to gather these learnings and to do this analysis is part of how change happens. And I think it's really important that we learn those kinds of things. And that right there would be the kind of policy change we could put in place in a lot of states and communities, and it could make a significant difference.
So Dr. Salaam, I know you've been advocating for some reforms with the New York legislature. So I know that you do the lobbying and the engagement with the communities in the way that John's talking about. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I like everything that's been said. You know, what I'm thinking about is that my vision is that they happen in tandem. Because, you know, as I was thinking about what's being said, what came to my mind and what kind of just kept on just kind of pulsating in my brain was the big question of why. Like, why are things the way that they are, right? And one of the things that popped up was the idea of separation of church and state, and how, you know, it was legal in this country for people to own people. Like, that was a law. And if we unfortunately move and continue in the way we have been, then the problem, and this is why I always say we're fighting spiritual wickedness in high and low places, because the problem is, what happens when you come across the people who are greedy, the people who want to abuse people. You know, we have to have the people who have been run over by the spike wheels of justice, so to speak, at the table. Because a lot of times the people who are making the decisions are not affected. You know, I mean, there's a lot of intelligence, and I think that that part has to happen in tandem with everything that's going on to help guide things. Because I think what John spoke about in terms of the Quattrone Center and how they have the data, then they do the experimentation and stuff like that, that's so needed. That's like, that model has to populate itself around the nation in order for things to really be moving forward in a positive way. The problem is things like one hand washing the other. Oh, that's my friend over there. Mm-hmm. I'm going to protect them. Donald Trump saying, hey, tell me about self-pardoning. See, what blew me away? I mean, when I say blew, I mean, I was so destroyed when Trayvon Martin died. I was destroyed when Sean Bell died. I was destroyed when Amadou Diallo, and I say died, I'm putting a better spin on it than what really happened, when they were murdered, right? And I was destroyed because I couldn't, for the life of me, understand how could this be. And even years later, like, we look at some of the cases that are now being adjudicated and things are coming out like, oh yeah, no, they're not going to prosecute the people who did this to that person and that to this person. And these are people who are supposed to be protecting us. And I keep thinking about what we are fighting. We want the ideal, and I think the ideal is what we should fight for and continue to work towards and march towards and uplift. But man, when I tell you that we haven't really seen evil, I mean, if history in terms of slavery said that they would sometimes take babies and feed them to alligators, to catch the alligators. Like, where are we? I was watching the movie Antebellum and was blown away by the statement, I think it was from William Faulkner, I think that's who they were quoting, about the past. They said something about the past isn't dead, it's not even the past. You know, the central
well, yeah.
Yes. I was going to just quickly wrap that part up and say the Sandra Bullock jogger case happened, and the way it was taught in school was that these were evil people who did this evil thing. And people learned that, right? And then you found out years later, 13 years later, that the truth was that we actually had not done that thing. But when you look at all of the oppression and the atrocities that go on as a result of the criminal justice system, the system that I call the criminal system of injustice, it's almost as if between the two, you have Emmett Till and then George Floyd. But there's so many other things that have gone on that historically the system says, we got to sweep that stuff under the rug. The rug is getting bumpy. I mean, we got some real major, major problems. And I think the smart people in the room, in the country, are working it out. But then the other part that I'm most concerned about is about the spiritual wickedness that we are fighting against. Because see, what happens is they like, as, and this is crazy, I'm thinking about it from this perspective, you know, as they move our cheese around, right? We try to figure out, hey, who moved our cheese? Where's the new cheese at, right? We've read books about this stuff. But as we figure out how to fight, they change the laws. They kill us. They try to create a situation that is so unbearable that we capitulate and say, okay, we will be the oppressed. But we who believe in true freedom, justice, and equality know that there's a better way. And on the other side of that, regardless of what happens, we have smiles on our faces because of what we've done. And I think that that's the part that's the beauty of it, right? The beautiful struggle, as they've said. It is a struggle. And we've been fighting this struggle for eons.
Too long.
And now they've codified things, made it into law, allowed it to be practiced. And we're trying to fight against the system that made the law, and hoping that we can talk to the heartstrings of people so that they can make those reforms and make those changes. And sometimes it's happening. There's changes that are happening. But it almost feels like we're also doing a tango, two steps forward, one step back.
John, you're leaning forward. You look like it's like there's something you want to add.
Well, you know, I Dr. Salaam touched on a lot of issues, but I feel like it is so interesting thinking about the difference between the letter of the law and how it's applied.
Absolutely.
And it was interesting seeing some people's response to what we saw last week with the ransacking of the US Capitol, the assault on the Capitol. Some people's response to that was, we need to write more anti-terrorism laws, or we need more domestic terrorism laws, or laws that specifically address white nationalist organizations. And I'm always a little wary of that response, because what still ends up happening is discretion is involved in so many ways that the law is applied. And if we don't address the issue of discretion, there were choices made. Choices made by the Capitol Police, choices made by whoever would authorize whether or not the National Guard was in place, or any other decisions were made around how to make sure that the Capitol was protected. Those choices were made differently when Black folks were marching and other folks were marching for Black lives over the summer. There were different choices made. And you didn't have to change the law to change those choices. Mm-hmm. Those were decisions made based on discretion. And so that's why we spend so much energy thinking about who's in power and who's got the discretion to make the kinds of choices that will affect so many lives. And that is why we focus so much on electing progressive prosecutors, because they have so much discretion about how the law is applied, what the charges are, what the bail is set at, what the negotiations will be like when it comes to plea bargaining, what the ultimate sentence will be, is written in the law. But if the prosecutor has discretion over even what the charge will be, they also have discretion over what the sentence will be, because those things run, you know, are kind of executed in tandem. Mm-hmm. And so I think we have to think a lot about who's got discretion in these major decision points, and make sure we have transparency into what they're doing and accountability, and that they're responsive to the people and what the people want. And that's why we focus so much on prosecutor elections. Dr. Salaam's life would have been different if the right prosecutor was in place that was taking a proper accounting of what the evidence was and wasn't acting rashly and trying to just get an answer rather than get to the truth. And so many other people's lives would have been different if there was a prosecutor in place that actually cared about doing the right thing, doing the thing that was just and that was fair. And that's what we've been focused on throughout the country, whether it was Los Angeles with George Gascon or Chicago with Kim Fox or right there in Philadelphia with Larry Krasner. We've fought to make sure that people with a moral compass, people with understanding that justice needs to be tempered with mercy, people who have understood what the inequities have been in our country for a long time and want to right those wrongs, that people like that are running our prosecutors' offices because their discretion is so determinative of outcomes for so many people's lives.
Yeah, well, and I think, you know, Dr. Salaam, you and your Exonerated Five colleagues, right, are five of more than 2,700 known confirmed exonerations across the United States. There's a fabulous resource that I'd recommend anybody listening to this called the National Registry of Exoneration that tells the stories of all 2,700 and counting. And we're adding, you know, discovering more and more exonerations on a daily basis. And I think one of the things that's interesting is even when we get one of these new prosecutors in, John, you know, a George Gascon, a Kim Fox, watching what's happening in Los Angeles right now is really fascinating, right? George is a former police chief of the Los Angeles Police Department. He was the DA in San Francisco. He's not, you know, a pushover. You know, he's not soft on crime. And yet there's so much going on about the question about his modifications of sentencing policy and so many of the existing prosecutors that are there. You know, have you guys run into sort of the limits of prosecutorial authority and the backlash from the system that Dr. Salaam is talking about too? And what can we do about that when the chief law enforcement officer in a district still runs into those challenges?
Well, they're going to run into challenges because there are vested interests who like the system the way it is now. Chiefly, it's been a lot the police unions, the FOP or whatever the equivalent is in the different states and districts, and also people who make money off of imprisoning people. Both the unions of those the officers that work in corrections, but also corporations that make money off of it, or communities whose primary employer is the locking up of people. So there are vested interests. There are people whose livelihoods depend on us keeping the system the way it is. But what we found is that when we make the case to the public, who's making the choice, the electorate who's making the choice, when we've made that case to them, more often than not, they've voted for the more progressive prosecutor. So the friction is always going to be there. There's resistance is always going to be there. But I'm optimistic that despite that resistance, we can elect progressive prosecutors and they can get reelected. Kim Fox just got reelected in Chicago, even despite all the controversy around Jesse Smollett and all the other attacks that she has had to endure. She's reelected. And I believe that she has shown that you can both be progressive and make the community safer, because crime has gone down there. Crime has gone down in Philadelphia. Crime went down in San Francisco under George Gascon's leadership. So they've proven that we can keep people safe, but also make our system less punitive and oppressive to the communities that are targets of it. So I realize there's opposition, but I feel like we can win.
Well, and so Kim Fox, who in full disclosure is also on the advisory board of the Quattrone mm-hmm. Center, and we're very proud to say that she is. One of the things that she has done also that I hope more prosecutors will emulate is she has published a lot of the data about what goes
yes, on. Yes, transparency.
And I think that will allow people to really learn how the system is working so that you can have these more informed community conversations that you're talking about. And for prosecutors, criminal justice in general, I think is so many of the people that work in these, and I'm talking, you know, so many good people in police departments and prosecutors' offices nonetheless see the data as ways for people to attack them instead of ways to facilitate productive conversations so that they can actually are more empowered to do the job that they want to do and serve the community. that I think that's been a great thing.
I just want to say I encourage every prosecutor to be transparent about their data, not just for election sake, but so you can understand what you're doing. So right. You can hold yourselves accountable. You have a staff of line prosecutors who are doing most of the day-to-day work. You want a way to assess what they're doing. You want a way to understand what patterns emerge, whether you see a pattern of bias. You don't want to hide that. You want to say, oh, let's find it. And if we find it, let's fix it. I think for so long, these elections weren't paid attention to. A lot of times people ran unopposed. And so people just felt like people in these prosecutors' office felt like they didn't have to be accountable to anyone. And now that we're paying attention, now that these elections are actually fought, where they're a contest of ideas and perspectives, I think it's important that we also introduce transparency and data into these discussions. And that way, when you see these anecdotes in the New York Post or these anecdotes on Fox News or these other more conservative papers that want to sensationalize, oh, there's been a wave of crime, or they are very interested in telling a narrative that if you start being less punitive, you're going to create more crime. They're very interested in that narrative. And the best way to fight that narrative is with transparency and data that shows here's what we're actually doing and here's what the results are.
Nice.
So Dr. Salaam, we have actually a question that I think John may have just answered this question in advance, but I'll turn it to you to get your answer too. We actually have a local prosecutor who submitted a question. And I think the first thing I would say is hats off to a local prosecutor for being part of this conversation, right? I think that's a wonderful thing. But his question is, look, I'm in a jurisdiction with 625,000 people in my county, 900 police officers. What's a concrete practice or paradigm from my office that I should change to have big impact in my community and with my police department to sort of achieve the vision that you're talking about?
Wow. That's a big question. I think a big part of it has to deal with understanding where these people come from, what their stories are, because with the Central Park jogger case, one of the worst things that happened was that, for one, they didn't do what they usually did, from what I understand, in New York, where they put the names of the judges in a wheel, and then they roll the wheel, and then they blindly pick out a name, and then they put that judge on the case. Similarly, with the prosecutors didn't have an interest in the truth, right? And so when they painted the picture of who we were, there were over 400 articles written about us within the first few weeks of this case. Donald Trump's ad that ran in New York City's newspaper, this ad was published May 1st of 1989. That means that this so-called crime happened April 19th, 1989. Donald Trump already had his people thinking about what they were going to do, how they were going to do it, and what they wanted to put out there. And then they created this. So this was already conceived prior to May 1st. I'm saying that because they were painting a narrative of who we are. And they were trying to make people see us this way. And if they saw us this way, it's the same thing that I believe Muhammad Ali was saying when they were telling him that they wanted him to go over and fight the war in Vietnam, if I'm not mistaken. And he was talking about how if he wanted to fight a war, he could fight here. This is where his real war and his battle is, But what he said, which was very interesting, I think it was he that said it. He said, they call them goops. And when you call people other than human, you can do anything to a subhuman, to somebody who you made into something else. seeing people, for who they are, and also trying to understand Newton's third law of motion. For every action is an equal and opposite reaction. Why is that young lady out there raising hell? Why are those people doing what they're doing? What's their story? And I think there's beauty in that, there's grace in that, there's opportunity in that, right? People, you know, when you think about the science, they said that people's brains don't fully develop until 21, 25. And so imagine in the criminal justice system, a good friend of mine, Mac Moten, who was known back in the days as a 25 caliber kid, right? He was in prison from 1989, 1990, and he is still in prison. He never came home. He came home for a little bit, but got rearrested and charged and been in prison all this time. I'm having a conversation with him the other day, and he says, wow, you know what, Yusef, man? You know, I just realized nobody ever gave me a psyche eval. This is a grown man now thinking intelligently about the system and the issues. Now, mind you, he did some wrongs. But imagine if he was evaluated, he could have been treated properly, right? And part of the care that goes along with protect and serve, that goes along with prosecuting and all of the things, keeping law and order in place, is being caring about those people that you are over, you know? And there's grace in that. It doesn't have to be.
I love that idea of humanizing people. I mean, I think it really has so much to do with how we think about how public safety works, how our communities will be healthier and safer. And I really believe that this prosecutor who asked the question, if one of the things they do is really have outreach to the community where they're getting to know the people who live there. And also, one of the things I discussed with some prosecutors over the years is that very seldom do any of them actually visit the places where they send people. You know, the prisons, the jails, these facilities. Very often they don't even connect with these places where they're sentencing people to go for 20, 30 years. And so they have no sense of empathy for what they're asking the system to do to these people. And, you know, I think I'm just saying amen to what Dr. Salaam says about humanizing folks and realizing that no person should be defined by the worst thing they've done, and realizing that there's a lot more to their humanity. That when we dehumanize them, it allows us to do all sorts of things to them that otherwise we wouldn't do.
Yeah.
Well, and I think also for too long, when I was growing up, we used to talk about people paying their debt to society. Mm-hmm. And that concept, seems to have been forgotten. Once you get labeled as somebody who has committed a crime, the lack of humanization continues even after that sentence has been served, right? And I know both of you have dealt with this issue in different ways of returning citizens and what can we do about that. I'm hopeful now that we've got so much science showing that people age out of violence, and mm-hmm. that, as you know, that people who are older than 50 years old have a very, very low likelihood of violent recidivism, that we can begin to return more and more of these people to their community. John, why don't you talk about Unlocked Futures and about how you're working to improve that? Because I think if we could realize, to your point, that even if I am defined, even if my life has been changed by the worst thing I've done, that's not the limit to who I can be.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And you know, the way I look at this is personal, because I have multiple family members who are returning citizens, people who spent some time in prison, spent some time in jail, did something. None of them are claiming they didn't do it. So they were convicted properly. They were sentenced. And what do we do with them after they come home? Do we continue to punish them? Do we continue to treat them like outcasts? Or do we decide that they are us? They're part of our community. In my example, they're my family. They're the fathers of and mothers of my nieces and my nephews. They're people who need to support their family, want to feel part of something, want to build a better life. So I believe they should be voting. I believe they should be able to get hired. I believe they should be able to get loans and housing and all these other things that make them part of society and give them the opportunity to build a life. Because one, it's better for them, but two, it's better for us too. It's better for us if they have a purpose, if they don't have to turn to the black market to make money, if they don't have to turn to the underground economy to make money. It's better for all of us. It will reduce recidivism. It will make us all safer. It will make our economy better. And we will be able to utilize their minds. We have to look at them as part of our human capital, where our society is stronger if we make the most of our human capital. And we cannot exclude returning citizens from being part of what we think of as our community and our human capital, that will have the next great idea, that will have the small business that will employ people, that will be great employees that can help build a company. And that's why we started Unlocked Futures, because these folks have ideas. They have ingenuity. Some of them were hustlers. They were doing it illegally before, but we can find a way for them to do it legally and use that same hustler's energy and that same ingenuity to do something that won't get them locked up. So we wanted to provide that opportunity. We partnered with Bank of America. We partnered with New Profit to advise them, to fund them, give them the opportunities to network with each other and with other professionals in their industry and build businesses, build nonprofits, build enterprises that would employ other people and would make a difference in the world.
Wow. That should be rolled out around the country. Matter of fact, it should be rolled out around the world, because you know, when I think about being a returned citizen for a crime that I didn't commit, right? I mean, it's so easy for a person who's been run over by the spike wheels of justice to then go into a life of crime because of that, right? And I think about just the whole idea, the wording, right? It used to be called the correctional facility. People went to a place to get a behavior corrected, to pay their debt to society, and then to come back to society to participate. And that's the part that's meaningful and important, because once you deny a person the opportunity to participate, as John has said and so beautifully said, is that they then turn back to, like, you, they'll try. And I think part of the beauty of that is that's one of the pieces in when they see us, right? You see how we all came back home and we were all trying, and Raymond Santana's story was given a lot of meaning in that particular piece, because we needed to see he was denied the opportunity. We all were denied, but because he was denied and he said, you know what, I don't need to fill out a job application to do this. But when he did that, it caused him to go back to prison. You know, whereas had he been given the opportunity, just like we all wanted, there would have been no prison.
Time we lock someone up, it's a failure of our community, because we failed to put that to give enough opportunity for that person to live, to make money, to do the things they need to do, to educate themselves, to be healthy, to be safe, and not commit crime. It's a failure. And that means that if we are going to lock someone up, let's try to turn that failure into success. Let's actually make the most of the time we have with that person and really change their lives. Because the vast majority of people that go to prison don't stay for very long. just because most of the crimes people commit aren't that serious. But they go for a little while and then they have to come back home. And if we're going to make the most of that time where they're out of society, we need to make sure we have proper educational opportunities for them, proper ways for them to feel a connection and find a passion in something that they like to do. And then remove the barriers once they get out, once they return to the community, remove the barriers that are in their way that would preclude them from contributing fully to society.
Yeah. Wow.
So we're running close to our time ending here, but we had a couple questions, Dr. Salaam, about your book, Punching the Air. So I'd love to hear you talk about that project and why you undertook it and what you hope it will do. And I guess the last question is, my understanding is they're talking about maybe putting a statue of the Exonerated Five in Central Park as a statement of the importance of people remembering what was done to you. And I'm curious, I'd like to hear both about your book and I'd like to hear your thoughts on what that would mean.
Yeah, so the punch in the air really is a labor of love. I mean, it's a love offering.
I gotta say, your Zoom background is so much cooler than mine. You've got the ad, you've got the book right there.
Both of yours are cooler than mine.
Oh, right? Man.
Simplicity.
Oh, listen. I mean, you know, so Punch in the Air was really my attempt to really talk about the criminal justice system and how we can make some changes, but also talk about life, talk about America, talk about the issues that we talk about. Like, we have these conversations, but I haven't yet really seen it in a book form. And so we may live in a gentrified neighborhood as an example, but in the book we talk about gentrifying neighborhoods and what happens in that process. Here people are living in a community, the community is being beautified and made to be whole, and the people who are coming in are finding these spaces for the first time and they're planting their flag. This is my park. This is my this, this is my that. But what about the people who were there already? And then we're also talking about the educational system and how people can be turned into something that they're not. One of the most powerful pieces of all, I mean, there's so many powerful pieces in here, but this book was written really in like a poetic format. And this is a piece that I always love to share on page 56. It's called Clone. And it simply says, Clone. Ever since that day in the fifth grade, my teachers watched me so hard, so close, that I felt like I was trying to break out of prison, even though it was just school. Every dumb thing I did, they thought it was because of trouble at home, an absent father, a tired mother, not enough books, not enough vegetables, not enough sleep. They believed those lies about me and made themselves a whole other boy in their minds and replaced me with him. And I mean, that happens, that doesn't just happen to children, right? That happens all the time with all people, with, I mean, you know, so Punch in the Air, like I said, is a labor of love, it's a love offering. It is about a victory, but it's also about fighting the unknown and what you can't see. And when you finally get an opportunity to begin to perceive the future, you can re-engineer backwards where you are so that you can make that a reality. We don't get to the future or the end point in this book because we kind of leave it open, possibly maybe a part two and some other variations of Punching the Air. And the great thing too is that I'm working on my memoir, Better Not Bitter. That's going to be released in May. Better Not Bitter really is about not just, you know, we've seen our story portrayed beautifully and tragically, not tragically because it was a tragedy, but because it was so beautifully made with Ava DuVernay's retelling of our story, When They See Us. We all cried. I mean, that story, us seeing our truths, our stories on the big screen, broke us down and built us back up again. I mean, we went from being a brotherhood to a sacred brotherhood in When They See Us. And so one of the things that I wanted to do was kind of take my story and expand it a bit to really talk about the whole fullness of me. The fact that I was a child, that I grew up, I had dreams and aspirations. My mother was a professor at a fashion institute, Parsons University. You know, we didn't come from nothing. And the truth of the matter is that that part of the story is never told, yeah. Right? The way that we are introduced to society is as the scum of the earth, mm-hmm. Right? The people who need to be put down, you know, on the heels of Donald Trump's ad, Pat Buchanan a few weeks later wrote in the papers, why don't we just take the eldest one and hang him from a tree in Central Park? He wrote this in the New York Post.
Yeah.
Why don't we take the others and horsewhip them? I mean, imagine if his words had bigger effect. They had published our names, phone numbers, and addresses in New York City's newspapers. And so people knew where we were. And I think they were hoping for the unfortunate tragedy that happened to Emmett Till to happen to us. You know, and so the other part, too, is that there's another book that I wrote. It's called Words of a Man, My Right to Be. This is my first book, actually, self-published book. This book is the book of poems that I wrote that I read over and over again that encouraged me to remember what I was doing and what I was fighting for and why. Right. And so maybe just one piece from here I'll read. It's called Venus and Mars.
Okay, I know that we have kind of a hard stop on the video, so we've only got about 60 seconds left.
Oh, shucks. In between Venus and Mars is the center of our attraction. Of those connected to the stars, hardly a fraction. It behooves man to work for the day when this will all end. Life is mortal, so follow the way of those heaven sent. Awaken and receive that which will give you life, or remain horizontal and never begin the flight. For the solution, I'll descend from amongst the stars, and I'll meet you in between Venus and Mars.
Wow.
I need you to write some R&B songs too.
You know, I've had the good fortune to meet a number of exonerees, and I'm always amazed by their grace and their serenity after what they've been through. And you're certainly living proof of that. I can't thank you enough for sharing your time and those words. John, the way you've used your platform to touch so many lives, and both of you to create the humanity that you're talking about here, it's been a real gift to get to spend this time with you and to share your perspectives with the world out there. Thank you so much for spending your time with us. And we will look forward to keeping in touch going forward.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.